I was the host in 1978 of one of the Saturday Night Live shows. I think it is, in fact, the most important thing I ever did in 50 years.
You don't?
I really do think so.
Why?
Because, well, I was told the next morning, thank God I wasn't told before, that 35 million people watched the show. And that's quite a large number. And I was fortunate enough to be working with John Belushi, Dan Aykroyd, Bill Murray, Gilda Radner, Lorraine Newman, Jane Curtin, and so on, who were absolutely brilliant at the height of their powers. They all went on to become major stars. I think what really sort of turned everything around for me, to a certain extent, was the fact that it was comedy.
Mm. Yes.
And a sort of wild way out in crazy comedy. You could do literally anything. If you fell over a camera, well, didn't matter. You know, I was actually
sitting.
Well, no, never looked down. And I was, for instance, between one sketch and another, sitting as close as I am to you with the audience in the studio. And I would say to them, oh, you would excuse me while I take off my trousers and put on the next pair, you know, because the next pair trousers I'm going to wear. I became slightly incoherent at that point. But nobody turned a hair. It didn't bother them a bit.
Fabulous.
But this was the atmosphere. You could do anything.
Yeah.
And I think that what happened was that people said at the end of it, well, we've seen him terminating a few people over the years, but he can be funny.
Yes.
And it opened up a whole new career for me. And all right, you can say he can be funny. Of course, it was the material.
Mm.
We had about 15 writers.
Good writers.
Oh, yes, and they would rush up to you just before you're doing your most important scene, because it's an hour and a half.
Yes.
And you're literally leaping between scenes and different changes of clothing. And somebody would say, now, don't forget, you must, don't forget that. Don't say, don't push your luck, press your luck. Or don't say, don't press your luck, push your luck. And they would come up literally within seconds and change a line, say, no, you can't say that. Do this, do that. No, wait a minute, no, you look over there. I said, but in the rehearsal, no, look over there. So this would go on and on and on. Well, if you can survive that.
Just like that today, because we're going to get changed trousers.
So I feel so, so I feel so at home, I could see you all changing when I came on.
It was America that allowed you to do that then. Would
yes.
they have allowed you to do that here, do you
no,
think?
No, never.
You'd never have got
never.
That chance to be
never.
That funny here.
I would never have played in a film called Serial,
yeah.
which was an American movie made for Paramount, in which I played an American businessman, uh-huh. as an American, out there beating the bushes for talent, you know, and all that kind of thing, who was this ruthless headhunter during the week. And at weekends was the head of a band of Gay Hell's Angels. In black leather and chains and everything you can think of.
One of your favourite parts was
Christopher
Lee. Of course,
was yeah. the gay biker.
Yes, absolutely. Now, that would never have happened here.
No.
The sad thing is that I suppose it's part of our national psyche, in a sense.
That they would...
Sort of sense of caution.
They pigeonhole you. Sort of
oh, well,
yes.
But I got away from that by going to America.
But those films almost sort of resurrected the British film industry and kept it going
oh, yes.
for quite a number of years.
The most successful independent production company in the history of the British cinema was
yeah.
Hammer, and they deserve all credit for it. And it certainly started my career off after 10 mm-hmm. years of not really getting anywhere. Mind you, those 10 years weren't wasted, as we all know,
mm.
because those of us who've been through similar situations, and we all have in one way or another, instant stardom when we started didn't exist. It does now, after one picture, or even perhaps before you even show the picture.
Yes, yes.
You're the next superstar.
But you're 240 films down the line now.
More than that, actually.
More than 240 films.
No, when we started, if it didn't work, you kept going. You obviously were discouraged at times, but you didn't give up. Very much, I think, in our psyche, our national psyche, you might say. Don't give up. So I didn't. And during those 10 years, I learned. But everybody's in such a hurry these days, sadly. And they all want it in 5 minutes, or they seem to.
Mm.
But they were so successful, those films. I will never forget, and I'm sure you won't, when Sammy Davis Jr. was here, and
yeah.
he was one of my best friends, as you
yeah.
know, and he said, Do you know, you know everybody, do you know Christopher Lee and Peter Cushing? And I said, well, I don't really, but why? He said, well, I think their films are wonderful. Do you think I could get to meet them? And I called your agent and fixed up tea at Mayfair with Peter Cushing, Christopher Lee and Sammy Davis Jr. Yeah. And you came for, and he was thrilled. Do you remember that time?
I remember it very well. He was a very dear friend of mine also. And wonderful, brilliant entertainer.
Wasn't he? Yes.
And I was very fond of him. I miss him. He was enormous talent, enormous, much misused word. Yes. But he really had...
Did he come to the studio to see?
Yes, he did. He came down to Bray. We were shooting a pirate movie, I remember, because somebody showed me the photographs only the other day. And here is a man who was the biggest name in show business at the time in the United States. And he's just like a child with a toy, completely bowled over by... what he was watching. I don't remember if we were doing anything particularly dramatic or exciting, but whatever it was,
he
was absolutely in heaven. And of course, when I lived in America, I saw him quite often, went to his home. I knew his family very well. And he was a lovely person.
He was.
I miss him.
Much missed.